Well, welcome to Memorial Road Church of Christ. For some reason this morning, I really want to also say thank you to a certain group of people. You know, a lot of us come to church every week and we know who we're going to sit by, whether it's a friend or a family member. But there's a lot of you who come to our services and you show up and you don't know who you're going to sit by. You don't come to see specific people. And so I just want you to know that I'm really thankful that you come. I know that's really hard to get up when you don't have that close community. So I'm glad you're here today, and I hope you enjoy our worship and our time together. We're back in the story, which I'm thankful for. It's been a few weeks since we've got to do an actual chapter. So if you have a Bible, we're going to be in 1 Kings 18. This is one of the most iconic stories in the entire Bible, Elijah and Mount Carmel. There's a guy named Dan Gilbert, and he's a psychologist, and he's written a lot recently about happiness, the psychology behind what makes people happy and what makes people sad. And in his recent book, Stumbling on Happiness, he talks about a study that he did a few years ago in which he was trying to research reversible decisions versus irreversible decisions and how that affects people's contentment level. If you think about it, some of the decisions that you make are reversible. So you say to somebody else, yeah, I'll have dinner with you this week. Well, if something comes up, you can get out of that commitment. You can change that one. Well, there are other decisions which are irreversible, so that once you decide this, it's really hard to go back. Buying a house, not like you can't go back, but once you sign the document, it's really hard to go back. Relationships are that way. Marriages are that way. There are some decisions that once you decide, you really don't get to go back. And so Dan Gilbert wanted to research how this affected our contentment level. And so what he did is he set up an experiment in which he was going to give posters away to people. So he had about a dozen posters, and he invited groups of people to come into this room, and they could select a poster and take it with them. One particular group, he said, you all, if you don't like your poster, you can bring it back and get another one within a month. With the second group, he said, whatever poster you pick, you have to keep that, and you cannot bring it back. And so in the subsequent weeks, he gave all these participants lots of surveys and questionnaires analyzing their contentment level with the poster. And what he discovered is that the group who could have changed their decision was consistently less happy than the group who the decision was final. It's really interesting to think about, because most of us would say, I would rather keep my options open. So if I can choose something that's definite, or I can choose something so that I can make a change later, most of us would say, yeah, we want to make the change later. But Gilbert's research is showing us that when you make a decision that's open-ended, your brain continues to work on the solution to that situation. So when you choose an outcome or decision that's final, your brain relaxes and you no longer work on the outcomes that didn't happen. And so in other words, you can boil the whole thing down to and simply say that indecision produces discontentment. Well, you don't have to talk to modern day psychologists to understand that truth. The Israelites came face to face with this truth thousands of years ago when they stood on Mount Carmel, and they got to see face to face that wavering between two options is okay for a while, but it's really not a place that you want to live. So here's how the story begins. The kingdom of God has been broken apart, as we talked about with Jeroboam and Rehoboam several weeks ago. For 208 years, the kingdoms of God, Israel and Judah, kind of limped out, finally ending in exile. 208 years, 39 kings. Only five of these kings were good. 34 were bad. One of these kings was a guy named Ahab. One of the most notorious men in the Bible, and his wife Jezebel was a piece of work. I mean, this woman, you wouldn't want to do anything with this woman. She had Israel terrified of her. She was not from Israel. This was a political marriage. Jezebel was from Sidon, and when she came into Israel, she brought her gods, mainly Baal. And so Ahab, wanting to please his wife, he made sure that all the worship centers around the land had worship for Yahweh, but they also had worship for Baal. And what's very interesting is that the people of God during this time, they did not become Baalists, but they did become syncretists. In other words, They wanted to keep believing in Yahweh because they had all these stories from their past which told them that maybe, just maybe, God would show up and do something again. And so they wanted to wait around just in case God had any perks left for them. But they were terrified of Jezebel. And so they worshiped Baal as well, so that they could play both sides of the fence. Yeah, we worship Baal because we don't want to get killed, because Jezebel had the reputation of killing prophets who did not worship Baal. And yet we also want to worship Yahweh because he might have some great perk that we don't really know about. And so Israel went both ways. Well, God wasn't super happy about this, and so God sends a drought. Now, droughts in modern day urbanized, industrialized culture, they're a bummer, and they might affect you a little bit, like maybe you can't water your lawn as much as you would like to, and maybe your grass isn't as green as you would like it, and maybe the weather's a little bit hotter, and maybe your plants are going to dry up a little bit. But in that culture, drought was a death sentence. Because if there was a drought, that would mean the plants die, and if the plants die, the animals die, and if the animals die, the people die. And so this was a serious problem in the land, and this drought didn't just last a few weeks. It wasn't even just a few months. It was 3 years. And the sun-scorched land hadn't received one single drop. And Ahab took this personally, because kings at that time, their reign was tied to how the land was doing. And so the land wasn't doing good, and so Ahab took this personally, and he wanted to blame someone. And not only was this Ahab's problem, but Baal was a god of fertility. And so Ahab was upset because he couldn't produce the rain. He was also upset because Baal couldn't produce the rain. And he had one person to blame, and that guy's name was Elijah. And so Ahab began searching for Elijah because he knew if he could find Elijah, all this problem could be solved. And so Elijah went into hiding for a few years. And finally, when Elijah came out, they have this conversation, which we read in 1 Kings chapter 18. When Ahab saw Elijah, he said to him, "Is that you, you troubler of Israel?" "I've not made trouble for Israel," Elijah replied. "It's you. It's your father's house. You have abandoned the Lord's commands, and you have followed Baal's. Now summon the people from all over Israel to meet me on Mount Carmel." And so Elijah says, "All right, you got a problem with me. Let's just talk the problem out. We'll have a good old-fashioned duel. Meet me on the mountain. It's BYOG. Bring your own God. Whatever the best God, he's going to win. Let's settle this like all the 9th century nomads do. Just bring it on. That way we don't have to deal with any long-term bitterness and resentment. Let's just get it out on the table." And so Elijah sets up this meeting on Mount Carmel. Now you have to know, Mount Carmel is a really intentional choice of location. There are other parts of Scripture which tell us that Mount Carmel is known as one of the single most fertile places in the region. And so what Elijah's doing is he's saying, "All right, we'll have a duel and we'll pick your home field. We'll pick the place in the world where Baal is the most difficult to defeat, your home turf." And so Elijah shows up on this mountain. And if you can just picture it in your mind, it's a fertile mountain. I'm imagining a blue sky. And on one corner of the mountain, probably a really big corner, is 950 prophets of Baal. This room seats about 1,000. So imagine all of us are prophets of Baal. And we're on one side of the mountain, and on the other corner of the mountain stands this one courageous prophet of God, Elijah. And then maybe a ways down the mountain are thousands and thousands of Israelites watching the duel to see what's going to happen, because they're the ones that stand in between, not knowing which God they should choose. And so the terms of the battle are very simple. Whichever God can produce fire, he is going to be the real God. Now Elijah gets up and begins this duel with a very compelling and short speech. There's no introduction, there's no illustration, there's no props, there's not any silly stories to start it off with. He doesn't even talk about a scripture from the Torah. He asks one brilliant question. Elijah went before the people and said, "How long will you waver between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal is God, follow him." You see, at this point, the people very simply want to follow both. They want Baal because to follow Baal means to accommodate the contemporary culture of the day. But they also want to follow Yahweh because to follow Yahweh means to honor the past. And this is one tension that so many of us get caught up in. How do I honor the past history of me and God, my family and I, my church and I, while at the same time accommodating to the current culture? It's very difficult to do. Now, the word that Elijah uses here when he makes this compelling speech is the word waver. How long will you waver? Well, it's an interesting word because what the word actually means is to dance. In fact, later in the story, when all the prophets of Baal are worshiping Baal, trying to get Baal to send fire from heaven, the word is used again. And in that context, it's all the people are dancing around, worshiping, singing, and they're dancing. And so what Elijah's saying is, how long are you going to keep dancing? How long are you going to waver between two different opinions? You weren't made to dance like that. Now, when I read this passage about wavering and hopping from one side to the other, there's a very specific scene from a movie that comes to mind. This is going to date me, but has anybody seen the movie Robin Hood Men in Tights? Okay. It's a really funny movie. And there's one scene where Robin Hood's about to cross a bridge, and a little John stands in the way, is like, you're not crossing my bridge. And Will, Robin Hood's faithful friend, is trying to tell Robin that this fight's just not worth fighting because the river's not that big, and so you really don't need a bridge to cross this. And so watch this scene from Robin Hood Men in Tights.
Look, this ain't exactly the Mississippi. I'm on one side, I'm on the other side. I'm on the east bank, I'm on the west bank. It is not that critical.
Okay, there's the gospel for you right there. It's actually, I think, a very good picture of what's going on Carmel. I'm on one side, I'm on the other. As Elijah makes his speech and says, I'm not sure if you can have both at once, it's very interesting because the people's reaction goes like this. The people said nothing. And as I wonder about that, or I think about that, I wonder, why exactly did they not say anything? A preacher friend of mine says this, which I really agree with. He says, you know, when you're reading your audience, when people say amen, that usually means one of two things. That usually means either A, I really like what you just said, or B, the person sitting next to me really needs to hear that. Now, we're not a big, you know, we're not a huge amen culture, but every once in a while, one of you will you say amen, and usually that means that we're on the same page. Like, yeah, I understand. You understand what I'm saying. You think something that is meaningful, and so you say amen. Although I will say that one time I was speaking at some other youth rally, and there was someone who didn't quite understand when to say the amen part. Usually, people say amen like after a great point or something. And I remember I was like 3 minutes into the talk, and I was like, hey, if you have a Bible, just go ahead and turn over to the Gospel of Luke. And she was like, amen. So I don't know if that meant like she just really likes the Gospel of Luke or she just wasn't listening. But anyway, so yeah, amen. Usually it's I like it or that person needs to hear it. But silence is pretty different. Silence either means you're sleeping or it means that you've just been hit between the eyes. And I think the people of God have just been hit between the eyes because they thought that the wavering was practical. This is great. I could have a little bit of Baal and get the perks of Yahweh. This is wonderful. And so to have Elijah come in and say, no, I'm not sure you can have both, I think they've just been hit and they don't know what to say. And they're not wanting to believe that truth. They're saying, I don't know, Elijah. You say that, but I'm just not sure if we believe that. And so the rest of the story really becomes simply a demonstration of the opening line of his speech. You can't waver. And so here's how the story goes. Baal's prophets get the opening kickoff. And nearly 1,000 people shout and dance and sing and worship all day long. 950 people for 16 hours, somewhere around 15,000 total man hours, going crazy, cutting themselves, being as worshipful and energetic as they possibly can, and they receive absolute silence from Baal. And then one man gets up, says one prayer, Yahweh sends fire from heaven. He ends the drought. And when the people of God who have been watching the duel see the decisive victory of Yahweh, they shout at the top of their lungs, "The Lord, He is God. The Lord, He is God." You see, they've been convicted. You see, in the beginning of the story, the people are dancing because they don't want to miss out on either side of the equation. But by the end of the story, the people who used to be dancing people are now devoted people because they realize that one of the two options leads to destruction. You see, here's the reality. Every single one of us have a waver zone. And a waver zone is that one area of your life that you are most tempted to share God's story with another. And notice, I did not say reject God's stories. I said share God's stories. Because there's a difference between a waver zone and a wicked zone. A wicked zone would be something that you are overtly doing something against the will of God, and you know it. You're saying something to someone else that you know is hurtful, but you do it anyway because you just don't care. Or you do something, think something, say something, and you know for a fact it's a direct attack against your God. That would be what I would call a wicked zone. But a waver zone is very different. A waver zone is where sinful and spiritual live together. A waver zone is where you have competing narratives in your life and you simply want the perks of all of them. So you want comfort from your friends, you want power from your job, you want pleasure from him or her or it. You want forgiveness from God, you want escape from a hobby or an addiction, and you want to throw it all together to be one new faith that's centered on you. What is your waver zone? What is that one area of your life where you want to share God's story with another? I want to give you three questions which might help you define what your waver zone might be. First question is this: where do I use the word just? Just one glance. It's just a few dollars. It's just one time. It's just for fun. You see, one of the key markers that there's a waver zone in your life is that one area of your life that you justify your behavior by using that little powerful word, just. You see, wading into the waver zone usually begins with small adjustments, not dramatic abandonments. Question number two, what do I justify through comparison? Sure, I look at soft images, but that's not as bad as so-and-so. Sure, I spend more money on myself than I give away to others, but I'm really not as materialistic as that one person in my life. Sure, I think I'm better than everybody else in my world, but at least I'm not as judgmental as that person, and at least I'm not as legalistic as that person. Sure, I don't have a relationship with God, but at least I'm at church. Like, think about all the people who didn't even go to church today. At least I'm not sitting at home. Doesn't that count for something? When you try to justify areas of your life by comparing yourself to other people, that's a danger zone. And that might be one area of your life where you're wavering between two different opinions, but you make yourself feel better by comparison. Question number three, very simply, where have I settled? Do you ever come across passages of Scripture where you read them and immediately you think, I don't live that way. I've settled for a lesser version of that truth. Maybe lines like, sell your possessions, or carry your cross, pray for your enemy. Lines like that. Sometimes when I read those, I think, wow, that's not me. I'm settling for a diluted version of the gospel. Be holy. There are certain parts of the Bible that are really difficult to live out, and so sometimes what a waver zone can be, it can simply be exchanging the authentic gospel of Jesus Christ for a lesser form. There's a brilliant sociologist named Christopher Smith came out with a term 6-7 years ago, which describes many church-going people in our culture today. It's a kind of a complicated term, but I think he's dead on. The term is moralistic therapeutic deism. And what he means by that is there is a growing number of people who claim to have faith in Jesus, but what they really have faith in is moralistic therapeutic deism. And what that is moralistic basically means life is about doing good. And as long as you tend to do more good things than bad things, then God's probably going to be pretty happy with that. And good people are going to get into heaven, and that's basically kind of the way the biblical story goes. Just be moral. Therapeutic simply means life's about being happy. And so I'm going to choose to do the things that bring me joy, and choose to do the things that bring me satisfaction, and choose to do the things that bring me pleasure, because life is about, it's that therapeutic sense. I just want to be happy. And then the deism part of this phrase has to do with this perception of God that, you know, he might have created the world, but he's really not that active in my life. He kind of set the thing in motion, he let it go, and he's off doing something else. And so because God's disengaged with me, I'm going to be pretty disengaged with him. And if I need something, I'll ask him. But for the most part, I'm just going to spend my life doing good and being happy, and hopefully it'll work out and everything will be great someday. And the scary part about this philosophy, moralistic therapeutic deism, is that so many people wake up every Sunday, go to church, are prayerful people, but really, they're just moralistic therapeutic deists. They're not authentic Christians. And the reason I'm saying all this is because it could be that your waiver zone is not necessarily one specific sinful behavior, like it's between, you know, purity and lust, or my waiver zone is between materialism and generosity. Your waiver zone might be about kind of a larger philosophical idea about how you're living your life. You might have exchanged the authentic gospel of Jesus, which is about giving your life for the sake of other people, for a diluted version which simply says, do good, be happy, get to heaven, it'll be easy. And the problem with that is that that's not what the Bible teaches. The Bible doesn't teach us to be moralistic therapeutic deists. There's nothing in that philosophy that has to do with Scripture. Like, the Bible doesn't say anything about how just being good and moral gets you anywhere with God. Like, I got news for you. Like, everybody who had a really moral weekend is in just as much of a standing with God as all of us who had an immoral weekend. And the reason is your behavior doesn't earn you anything with God. You're not saved by goodness, you're saved by grace. It has nothing to do with a set of behaviors that you can use to attain favor with God. It's grace. And this whole therapeutic idea, I mean, since when does the Bible tell us that life is about happiness? That can be a byproduct, but the Bible teaches us that life is about the glory of God. And this whole deism idea, you don't find that in the Bible. In the Bible, God is portrayed as this intentional, caring God who creates us in the womb, and he forms us and he shapes us, and he's the God who comes down to the earth, moves into the neighborhood. He knows the number of hairs on our head. He's the God that gets in our messes, gets in our life. He's the God that through his Spirit empowers us to pray to him using this phrase, Abba, Father, this relational phrase that a kid would use for his dad. This is not an aloof God who stays disconnected from us. And so there's nothing in the Bible that teaches moralistic, therapeutic deism. And the sad reality is many of us have adopted that philosophy and we think we're living as Christians, but really we're dancing around with something that's not Christian at all. I mean, think about the way Jesus lived his life. The guy went from city to city, and what happened when he went from city to city is that riots happened. People wanted to throw Jesus in jail. People tried to throw Jesus off cliffs. People spat in Jesus' face. People hated Jesus. Families were split apart because of Jesus Christ. And so what this means, why I'm telling you all this, is like some of us, we think that life is just about being good and nice and being happy and getting to heaven one day. For those of you that live that way, my fear is that you look more like Mr. Rogers than you do Jesus. You see, Jesus wasn't just about being nice. Like, there's more to being a Christian than just getting up every day and just being nice to people. That's not the gospel. At the heart of the gospel stands a crucified Savior who gave his life for the sake of people who hated them. That's more than being nice. You see, I would love to stand up here, and especially for like people new to Christianity, or I guess for seasoned Christians too, I would love to be able to say, hey, be a Christian. Here's what it's about. You just, you know, just be nice and come to church every once in a while, give a little bit of money, do a service project here and there, and everything's just great. It's easy. But that would be a lie. You see, at the center of our faith stands a crucified Messiah, a man getting murdered on a cross. And he's holding the sins of the world on his back. and he's holding the power of evil at bay. He's taking on the problem of death on himself as he's dying there on a cross, bleeding to death, suffocating to death, and in his final breath, he forgives his killers, and then he dies, and then Jesus Christ has the audacity to say two words, which I think are the single most challenging words in the entire Bible: follow me. So if you think that being a Christian, just getting out of bed and being nice, you've missed the boat. There is something deeper. About a year ago, I was leaving the parking lot at Memorial, and a guy was walking down Memorial Road, and he had a massive cross on his shoulder, just walking down the street. The bottom of the wheel, or the bottom of the cross had a wheel, and he was just walking down. It's like a 15-foot cross. And so I stopped and rolled my window down, and I was like, hey, what's going on? What are you doing? And he said, well, I just drive from city to city, and I get my cross out, and I walk down the streets of cities. And I said, why do you do that? And he said, well, I want to communicate the message that following Jesus is about carrying a cross, and it's difficult, but it's really meaningful. Well, I really agree with him. And sometimes in my life, I feel convicted that maybe I'm a Christian just for the perks, but I really don't want to put in the work. And maybe that's you as well. You see, there's a lot of hard stuff in life. There's a lot of difficulties in life. I'm sure that most every one of us come to church today with difficulties, whether that's someone in your life who's sick, or you're sick, or you've got tension in your job, or problems with a relationship. Everybody has difficulties. But my question would be, is your faith producing any difficulties? Does your belief in Jesus make anything difficult in your life? And if you have to say no to that question, like if you say, no, my faith makes everything easy, like there's nothing difficult about my faith, which faith are you living? If there's nothing hard about your faith, what faith are you living? Like there's nothing, the Bible doesn't say anything about following Jesus in terms of being easy. It says it's going to be difficult. It's going to be hard. And so if all you can say is, yeah, it's just pie in the sky, everything's wonderful, I'm just happy, I do nice things for people, but it's really easy, I'm not sure if you're living out the gospel of Jesus Christ. Like when Jesus said, follow me, what he's meaning is, I want you as my people to go out there and die to yourselves and live for the sake of a broken world. There's nothing easy about that. And yet it's so compelling and it's so meaningful. You see, many people are drawn to Christianity because it does have some pretty good perks. I mean, you want healing, like of past pain? Christianity is a pretty good worldview. You want forgiveness, you want grace, second chances, it's all in Christianity. Think about Jesus, think about all the things he does for us. I mean, he saves us from our past, he saves us from our sins, he saves us from emotional pain, he saves us from death. That's the big one. But please remember, Jesus Christ is not just your Savior. He's your Lord. And so many people want the perk of Christianity. Yeah, be my Savior. But they don't want to put the hard work in to make Jesus Christ their Lord. Because if Jesus Christ is your Lord, that means every facet of your life is submitted to his leadership and his lordship. And that's difficult. And so if you're not living that way, then it could be that you've got a waiver zone problem and that you want the perks of Jesus, but you just don't want to do the work. And so my question for you would be Elijah's question to his people: how long are you going to dance? Yeah, you see, I think that the reason the people of that day are so convicted is because they realize for the first time we can't dance forever. There's going to come a day when all the options that we think are out before us are not going to be there anymore, and there's going to be one option left. And if we've spent our whole lives on the wrong option, we're going to be on the wrong end of that boat. How long are you going to dance? You see, some people would hear a message like this, and they would say, well, Phil, thanks for a message about why not to be a Christian, because that sounds awful. I don't want to pick up my cross. I don't want to do hard stuff. I don't like that. I want to go back to the easy peasy, you know, pie in the sky, do good, be happy, it'll all be great. Give me that kind of Christianity. I'm not coming back. I don't want the hard stuff. Well, I'll end by saying, I can't speak for everybody here, but I can speak for myself. I'll tell you why I'm a Christian. I'm not a Christian because it overtly brings happiness. I think that can be a byproduct, but that's not why I follow Jesus. I have made the decision to spend my entire life under the lordship of Jesus Christ because I find his story, his worldview, the most compelling story in the world. Where else do you find a story where human beings are not the random aftermath of a fight between gods who don't care about them? Where else do you find a story where humans take up a big center of the creation? Where else do you find a story where suffering makes sense, not because of some interesting phrase that makes the suffering go away, but where do you find a story where suffering makes sense because God came down and suffered? That's an amazing story. Where else do you find a story where the end game is the renewal of all things, the new earth, the new heavens, the recreation of the world, the new world with no sick, with no pain, with no cancer, with no crying, no tears, none of that? Where else do you find a worldview not only that paints a picture of the end of time, but that invites me into that project? Like, this worldview, this story, it's so meaningful, it's so compelling, because I've got a part in it. Like, I'm part of the story, and so that's why I'm living it. Like, where else are you going to find a story where insignificant people like me actually matter in the story of God? Where else are you going to find a story where second and third and fourth chances are the normal? Where else are you going to find a story that is this full of forgiveness and healing and grace? It's the story of God. But this story cannot be lived when you're dancing with another story. And so I ask you one more time the same question Elijah asked his people: how long are you going to waver between two opinions? If there's some other God out there that's God, if there's some other worldview out there that's just as great as Christianity, great. Go follow it. Be a moralistic, therapeutic deist, whatever you want to be. But if God is God, follow him. If we can help you in any way, we invite you to come while we stand and sing.